You also say that when the Chinese try to intimidate, you know they're afraid of something. So try and explain that.
Well, I think right now, just going back into these broader themes of long-term trends, the Chinese are very good at intimidation. They intimidate countries that are much stronger than theirs, especially the United States. But we're coming to a point where I think that the Chinese leaders see a closing window of opportunity. And it's not just demography, where they're going to about on the verge of accelerated demographic decline. It's also they can see their economy has reached a high point. Their environment is exhausted. Chinese people are upset. They see restiveness around the world and in their own country. And they also see that the rest of the world is not in a mood to help China, because you've got a global economy that will be in a downturn this year. China is still export dependent. And they see factories leaving China for India. So that's why they're trying to intimidate you now, because they believe that they can do so now. They may not be able to do that in 3 or 4 years. And certainly they won't be able to do that in a decade.
You're saying that you feel that the Chinese economy is at its peak, whereas the Chinese government and leaders would like people to believe that they will continue growing for the next 3 decades at the same speed at which they've grown in the last 3. Why do you, Gordon Chang, feel that the Chinese economy could have already peaked?
Well, there's a number of things. First of all, you've got the coronavirus epidemic, which is more serious than the Chinese authorities are letting people know. And we have seen in societies around the world what the coronavirus has done to cause deep contractions. That's also happening in China itself. China has a problem, though, in that its economy is export dependent. And countries like the United States and indeed the European Union are not buying at the rate that they have in the past. And that's because their economies have also been stricken, but it's also because they were now starting to see political barriers to trade. Because of China's aggressiveness, countries are reacting to that. China is overburdened with debt, and we are seeing the consumers not rescue the Chinese economy. The most worrisome numbers for China are the import ones, because they show domestic demand. And in this calendar quarter, domestic demand is collapsing. In March, which was the last month of last quarter, imports were down 0.9%. In the 2 months of this quarter, they were down 14.2%, 16.7% last month. That shows an economy in decline. And I think the Chinese leaders understand that they don't have the tools right now to rescue it, because they don't have the ability to stimulate like they did in the past. So they know that they're in trouble. And one way to get out of trouble is to cause misadventure abroad, and that, of course, includes the Galwan Valley.
You wrote a highly controversial book called The Coming Collapse of China with Random House. Do you still believe that China will collapse? Why do you feel this way?
Yeah, in 2001, I said it would take a decade, so I'm out of time. The global financial downturn in 2008, I think, gave China the ability to extend its communist system. But, you know, I was wrong about timing. I do believe that China exhibits the same weaknesses today as it did when I wrote the book. And we're seeing Chinese leaders, as I mentioned, in this belligerent, provocative phase, which I think is a sign of a weakness. It's an admission on their part. Because they wouldn't be acting this way if they were confident. If they were confident, they would just allow global trends to take their course and dominate the world. I don't think they think that way anymore. So although I was wrong about timing, I still think that Chinese leaders betray a sense of fragility, and that is going to have horrible consequences, not only for India, but for my country and for countries around China's periphery.
But you also say that, you know, typically what it takes is some kind of domestic opposition, a political opposition. Only then does a regime change. So do you really sense that high level of angst and frustration amongst the Chinese people? I was in Beijing some time back, and, you know, while people don't talk very openly about politics, there was a general sense amongst the punditry in China that as long as they're making money, as long as the economy is growing, people are okay, even if some democratic freedoms don't exist, and they exist in India, but they see how things can get done and they tend to make their peace with the communist arrangement.
Yes, but the Chinese economy is not growing right now. It is, as I mentioned, as we can see from indicators, it is still contracting, and perhaps the contraction is coming deeper and deeper. You know, we've had Chinese people upset in various times during the history of the People's Republic, but it's never really come to anything. Even in 1989, when you had protests in 372 cities in China. But right now, what we have is something we haven't seen before, and that is unhappy people and an economy in decline.